One of the most common failure points that I've seen in home electrical are wire connectors. This is usually just a wire nut that is not securely held and the wires are backing out and then eventually lead to a bad connection and issues. So it's safe to say with many DIYers trying to take on home electrical, there's probably some additional information that's still needed, maybe some practice or just a few techniques that will help them make safe, secure, long-lasting wire connection. So we're gonna jump in and talk about 10 different things, kind of running through those. A lot of those are gonna deal with wire nuts, but it's not only gonna be wire nuts. We'll also touch on push-in connectors and my favorite, which is the WAGO lever nut, which are all options and could work for your application. Number one is you should not pre-twist your wires prior to using a wire nut. Now, I am guilty of this. I've had in past videos where I take my clients and I pre-twist the wires, getting a nice secure hold, cutting that off flush, and then I come in and place the wire nut on top. It does make for a strong connection, and I think it more makes for confidence that you have a strong connection because you actually saw the wires held together prior to the wire nut going on. But the manufacturer specifies you should not pre-twist and actually let the wire nut do the work. So let's do a quick demo of what that means. I'll take three 14 gauge wires stripped between 1/2 inch and 3/4 inch. I'll select the correct wing wire nut by looking at the manufacturer specification. This red one can go all the way from 2 18 gauge wires up to 4 10 gauge wires. Twist in the clockwise direction, making sure no copper is exposed past the plastic housing. And then I'll individually do a small pull test on each wire, which will give me the confidence that the wire nut is securely held and we have a strong connection. So we're just getting warmed up. I know number one is pretty basic, but it's good to get that baseline of how you should properly use a wire nut. Now, if you're a pre-twist kind of guy or gal, let me know in the comments and give me a little bit more information on the why behind pre-twisting. So now let's move on to number two. Number two focuses on when you're dealing with solid and stranded wire. Now, stranded wire is super common when you have light fixtures such as ceiling light fixtures, vanity light fixtures, or even maybe a dimmer switch or a smart home light switch. All those come with stranded wire because of the additional flexibility during the install. But when you're connecting a wire nut, there is a small technique that you need to use, and that is to lead with the stranded wire 1/8 inch above the solid wire before placing the wire nut. This will ensure that the wire nut is able to both hold the solid and stranded opposed to just threading onto the solid, leaving the stranded loose with a poor connection. All you need to remember is if dealing with that stranded, just lead with the 1/8 inch and you should be okay. Moving on to number three, I just want to touch on color. So the color does indicate the size of the wire nut and it associates to that minimum maximum. So the minimum number of wires engage and the maximum number of wires gauge. The only issue is there is not a standard across the industry. So whether you're using Ideal wire nuts or maybe 3M or another brand, you're gonna need to get comfortable with their color chart. Usually that's on the packaging itself, or maybe you just always use a certain brand so you're used to it. But just be careful that the color combination, just because it's orange, depending on who made that wire nut, it might not mean the same thing. Number four just goes into terminology. Maybe you've heard this before and not really known what somebody was talking about, and that is, opposed to calling this a wire nut, you might have heard somebody call it a murette. I don't really use the term murette very often, and I might not even be pronouncing it correctly, but I do know up, let's say in Canada, some regions could be more common to say grab a murette opposed to grab a wire nut. Number five actually goes into the origin of the wire nut and gives some insight on the name murette. And that's because wire nuts, you can track all the way back to about 1914, where a gentleman by the name of William P. Marr up in Canada started to experiment with new ways to connect wires together. So that was trying to improve on just splicing in and soldering wires like you might have seen back in knob and tube wiring days. Now, William P. Marr established the Marr Company, and the Marr Company had a brand named Murette, which was the most common maker of these twist-on wire connectors like we know of the wire nut. Interesting thing, going back to that pre-twisting and not pre-twisting. So nowadays you're not supposed to pre-twist, but if you actually look back on the patent application in the US by William P. Marr that was granted in 1933, you actually see a little bit different architecture where the actual twist-on connector would bring in a piece of metal that would pinch down the wire connection, but the wires were actually pre-twisted. So at least back then, you were supposed to pre-twist before you put on the twist-on connector. Number six, and now we are going to start to open up and talk more than just wire nuts and touch on push-in connectors and also the lever nuts. But with number six specifically, when we deal with the actual push-in connectors like this ideal push-in connector, those are suitable for solid core wire. So you can easily place solid core wire in there and they will securely hold. But it is not ideal for that stranded wire we talked about earlier. You should not place stranded wire within the push-in connector because it is not designed to securely hold stranded wire. So if you're starting to lean towards push-in connectors, just know in those applications where you have solid and stranded, you should not be using those. Number seven is going to touch on a feature found in push-in connectors and also lever nuts. So if we look at that ideal push-in that we just talked about, you'll see there's a little square cut out there. What that is, it's actually for your multimeter where you could insert a probe and connect up to the bus bar. If you're testing to see if you could get 120 across hot and neutral, you do not have to tamper with the push-ins at all because they have the diagnostic port built in. This is a three-wire WAGO 221 lever nut. This also, underneath that middle lever, it's kind of hard to see it, but there is actually a pass-through. If I pull that lever up, you can see a little bit more. There's a pass-through, again, where the probe could go in and connect up with the bus bar and give you an accurate reading. So kind of a handy feature of the push-in and also with the lever nuts is you can do your diagnostics, you can do your troubleshooting, testing voltage across the different wires without removing any of the connectors. Number eight is really more of a caution, and that is if you're dealing with a house that was built in the 1960s or 70s, there is a possibility that you still have aluminum wiring that was used during the time when copper prices were kind of going through the roof. If you have aluminum wire in your house, you can't just bring in new Romex with copper, solid core copper, and your aluminum wiring and use a wire nut. That is going to lead to issues. And there are specific connectors out there. You can Google Aluminicon lug connectors and you'll see there's connectors that can make that connection possible, but they're very specific and made for that purpose. Also, I've seen a little confusion on forums and discussion boards. When you look at some of the stranded wires like this one here, or even on this dimmer switch, you can see the silver color. That's not aluminum. That's actually a process called tinning, or the wires are tinned, and that is some solder that is on the outside of the copper that makes it a little bit more robust to oxidation. So those are still fine to bring in. That's just solder within there. It's not aluminum just because it has a silver color. So if you do have aluminum wire or suspect that you do, maybe it's just best to bring in a professional and get their feedback before going any further. Now, number nine actually calls out one area where wire nuts are really not ideal, and that's when you're dealing with vibration. Specifically, NFPA does call out in terminal boxes on an electric motor, you should not be using wire nuts. Most commonly, you probably see screw terminals in there to securely hold the wires and that the vibration wouldn't loosen up, let's say, a wire nut over time. So there are a few limitations, not commonly seen in residential, but more in the industrial space. And then finally, number 10, I think we all know that wire nuts are the most common in the United States and up into Canada as well. A lot of professionals really shy away from push-in connectors or the WAGO lever nut, but it's almost the flip side over in Europe, especially in the UK and Germany, where you might not even be able to purchase wire nuts, and the WAGO 221 or maybe a 222 is the go-to wire connector. And the funny part is that both sides kind of think that they're wrong and think that each other is crazy. So it just goes to show that there is something that we can learn from different regions and different techniques and kind of combine all those together to get the best of both worlds. For myself and talking to DIYers that take on electrical, the Wago lever nut is my go-to. And that's because even though the wire nut has been proven over time, it holds up really well. It also has been proven if you aren't comfortable with it and you aren't properly applying it, that it can cause a lot of issues. And I just think the Wago has a lot less room for error. And as such, I think it's ideal for DIYers. So that's the list of 10. Let me know in the comments. You guys did this. You guys were really great last time with the top 10 things you didn't know about an outlet or receptacle, where you let me know, say, if you're a professional or a DIYer, and how many you didn't know. So if there's only two that you didn't know and you're a DIYer, you would just put DIY 2, and then you can give me any other feedback because I'm always interested to hear from you guys. Now, before you take off, if you haven't subscribed to our channel, don't forget to hit the subscribe and bell notification so you get notified as we have multiple videos coming out per week to help you with repairs and improvements around the house. And we'll catch you on the next one. Take care.